was like, I think my feet are sweating. I have to put on socks.
I'm Stan Lee, and boy, are you lucky. You're watching Geek Out USA. Excelsior!
Welcome to Geek Out SA. This is going to be a great, great, great episode. And we have Alejandro here.
What's up? How are we doing?
The Urban Journalist.
Yes. I love that title, the Urban Journalist. That's awesome.
Well, why didn't we think of that?
Well, I wanted to the Geek Journalist, but, you know, that was taken.
No, I like Urban Journalist. I think that's a really cool title. Yeah, it gives you, like, a little flavor.
It's underground.
Yes.
It's like you're in there in the trenches and waiting for stuff with your camera and your mic.
Kind of like when I thought about the name, I kind of thought I pictured myself kind of like in a alley and like in the 80s and like with a Burberry trench coat, and I'm kind of like documenting stuff that nobody gets.
That's
urban
cool.
So. Well, I know we're going to be talking about Syfytonians.
Yes.
That presented by the Urban Journalist.
The Urban Journalist, mm-hmm. Yes.
And what made you decide to start doing the Urban Journalist?
Well, you know, I've been doing like docuseries for now 3 years. And you know, last year it of course originally was called This What's Poppin'.
Mm-hmm.
The content that I was putting there didn't really match, you know, and people would think This What's Poppin', they thought it was going to be like a 2 Chainz video or something.
Right. That was what I would kind of think, like, This Is What's Poppin'. I'm like, are you doing some dance moves or, yeah.
So, well, you know, some gang signs. No. No. But, so when I was working on Syfytonians, I was like, I have to change this up. Like, it's, you know, now I can't be using This What's Poppin'. And then This Was Poppin', Syfytonians. Didn't make sense. So, you know, it technically is kind of journalism.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, okay, well, you know, why don't we call it the Urban Journalist? And, you know, I kind of got my first taste of this business 3 years ago when I interned for a year at News4WAI. So
mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, well, it technically is kind of journalism. So,
mm-hmm.
So yes, so that's why I called it that.
Very cool. So, I mean, I started on this, like, 2 years ago doing Geek Out SA, and we used to do it from our home, and we had a webcam on our laptop or something, and just did it from home. From all the guests were at their own houses, and then we would just use, like, Google Hangouts to get it done. But that's when we first started, like, presenting, like, geek news.
And now
when we
you
started,
guys had your 100th episode in July.
Yeah,
congratulations!
So yeah, that was exciting.
I was like, oh my god,
I know,
like,
I did, right?
The Oprah show stuff, kind of here.
I was surprised. I was like, what? People want to hear what we have to say? No, just kidding. They don't.
Well, I did. I'd seen you guys, and I was like, oh my gosh, they look awesome. And I was like, I want to come on their show. So I kind of trolled.
Vince,
and I was like, please, like, get me on the show. And yeah, so when they said you're gonna be on the show, I was like, yes. So I'm excited.
Well, we're happy to have you because you've been doing some awesome stuff.
Thank you.
And from what we've seen so far, it looks really cool. So before we get into it, and before we show our exclusive footage of Syfytonians presented by the Urban Journalist, so. What made you decide, you know what, I want to document how a comic book convention, the comic book subculture in San Antonio, and how what made you want to do that? What drew you to that?
Well, it was interesting. It was something that it happened about 2 years ago, and it was, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine who had attended the first Alamo City Comic Con, and we were talking about our weekend, and he said, you know, I was like, what did you do? He's like, I went to the Alamo City Comic Con. I was like, oh, okay. He's like, dude, you need to do a story on it for What's Poppin'. And I was like, well, I was like, I don't know, because I didn't know much about conventions, and you know, I was like, well, what kind of story am I gonna get? You know, people in costumes, and again, I was unfamiliar with this subculture, and I didn't know it went beyond what, you know, what an outsider thinks. Mm-hmm. So I made a joke, and I said, you know, well, I'm not interested in doing a story about a convention at a broken down Walmart, and because you know, in the past, there's been other conventions. And he's like, no, dude, this is the Alamo City Comic Con at the Henry B. Gonzalez Center. Like, it's big. It was awesome. And so, for months, it was something that kind of haunted me in a weird way. Mm-hmm. Because I couldn't open a social media page or go to the movies or open a newspaper without seeing something related to the Alamo City Comic Con. So, finally, oddly enough, I'm walking into the movie theaters the first week of April to see Captain America: The Winter Soldier on a Friday.
Yes.
Night. And as I'm walking in there, I see a woman dressed in a Black Widow costume.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm a mainstream nerd, so my knowledge of superheroes comes from movies. So I didn't know the name of this superhero. So I called the girl. I was like, "Hey, Scarlett Johansson," and she laughs and. You know, she asked me, well, I told her, what are you doing here? What, you know, so we took a picture. And she says, oh, well, I'm here promoting the Alamo City Toy Show. And I was like, and I'm a huge believer in, you know, that we ask for things in life and they don't come in the way that we think. They come, but they come in a different mm-hmm. shape. And I said, okay, this is fate. I don't know what's in here, but there is something in here. And so I got a hold of Apple. We met and went to the toy show. And it changed my mind. I mean, just seeing all these artists, it was just a plethora of talent. And, you know, I think I'm someone who loves to create. So when I see mm-hmm. other people that are creative, there's something so electrifying about that. And it makes me want to be creative, too. And it inspires you. So, and I loved Star Wars growing up. That was
yes.
my thing.
Star Wars.
So, I can't wait for The Force Awakens.
Yes.
Yes. The rib goes wild. Yes.
I've been watching The Empire Strikes Back.
Mm-hmm. This,
no joke. Every night since the past 2 months.
Really?
So
nice.
I've been like obsessed with it.
Nice.
But no, and so I went in there and got to go to the Alamo City Comic Con, and it was just, I mean, it was this experience. I think the best way to describe it is, it's like getting Peter Pan late at night, knocking on your window and asking you if you want to go to Neverland. And
mm-hmm.
you just choke the crap out of Tinkerbell. And you just put fairy dust. And you just fly away into this amazing adventure. And
yeah.
It was awesome.
So I have a question, because you had said something, and this is something that's pretty common.
Yes.
You had made kind of a joke about going to a con at a broke down, you know, old
yes.
Walmart. Now that you've seen all the work that goes into Alamo City Comic Con, and you know some of us that do some of the smaller cons now, did that insight give you a different appreciation of what it takes to undergo something like this?
Yes. Well, and that was a very ignorant comment from my part. So
it's okay. It happens.
So it happens. But it made me realize that I am, believe it or not, we are all part of this community. Some of us are more aware of it than others. It's not like the Matrix
mm-hmm.
when Neo, like all the people there were part of the Matrix. They didn't know it, but Neo had the opportunity to kind of realize, oh crap, I'm living in the Matrix. So
right.
it was like, you know, Apple was kind of like Morpheus, and he's kind of like telling me, like,
he
no,
gave
no,
you the
no,
pill
no.
and you took it. Oh,
yes,
God.
I took the pill. But
he drank the Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
But I think one thing that I took away is that we're all part of it. And it was interesting because in the documentary, we meet some people from our community. We meet Diego Bernal, a state representative,
mm-hmm.
who is a huge fan of the Green Lantern and loves
oh.
Star Wars. He's in the story because there's something in the story that happens that's why he's there. You have a UTSA anthropology professor, Jamin Volbox.
I saw that in the
yeah.
clip, which I thought was great.
Who, you know, you would never think a college professor who is a huge fan of comic books, and he knows his stuff. When I was interviewing, I was, because, you know, again, not that knowledgeable. For my research, I read a little bit, but I still, you know, there's people that are more ahead of me. I would say I'm blue belt in comic books right now.
Yeah,
that's you guys are the black belts.
No, I mean, there's so much.
We're not, and that's one of the things we talk about on the show a lot is this acceptance that we need to bring into the culture of it's okay that you're a blue belt.
Okay.
And we're like maybe a green belt. We're probably not a black belt. Like we're not that good. I'm a big
Ninja maybe a brown belt. Well, it depends
on
the
comic because there's so many.
It depends on the subculture. Yeah. When we first started this. We started as it being to introduce the different subcultures within the geek community, and then just show you other aspects of it. So yeah, maybe this video gamer didn't know much about tabletop games. Maybe this tabletop player didn't know much about steampunk, or comic books, or whatever it is. We're trying to bring that geek community together because there's a lot that separates us, but still, we're part of the same family.
Yeah.
But there's more that unites us than separates us.
There is.
And it's interesting.
But we're just not so willing to see that.
Unfortunately. But it's interesting because I was thinking about this the other day, because I had somebody make a comment to me recently about, I don't understand. And I said, okay, well, you saw what was the last superhero film you saw in? This person said, "Oh, I saw Ant-Man. You should see it." And I was like, "Okay, you don't like this. You don't like the we were talking about the Alamo City Comic Con." And I said, "Are you going?" He's like, "I don't know. Like, I don't know much about that." And I was like, "Well, you saw Ant-Man, so you're part of this community."
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting what kind of a role these fictitious characters play in our lives. I mean, we go to HEB, we go to grocery stores. You're passing by the cereal aisle and you see, Spider-Man. And the thing that is a misconception is that it's not just superheroes. It's also like Disney characters. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's pop culture.
Mm-hmm.
You look at companies like Hot Topic, who in the early 1990s, millennium, they were known for gothic, punk rock type of clothing. Now it's strictly licensed. Companies like Old Navy, who have rebranded and been successful because of licensing. Abercrombie and Fitch, who were going through a hard time, and I never shopped there. Walked in there a while back ago, and I saw this killer vintage Superman T-shirt. I was like, I have to get it. It was I'm a little chubby, so you can see my love handles.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I'm gonna burn him at the stake later. Yeah.
So, it's interesting, like how people are really in Hollywood. I mean, how many superhero films are coming out? So
tons. Mm-hmm.
It's become a huge, it's like Coca-Cola, it's like Pepsi, it's become a huge part of our lives, mm-hmm. and we're all a part of it. So.
Definitely. I have a comment here from Mastermind Russell. I was the same way. I was introduced to the con world and was amazed at the world, and then I never knew it existed. Now I can't stay away from it. So, and that's something that, I mean, you need to educate some of these people. Oh, yeah, I don't want to go to comic. I don't know anything about comics. But Comic-Con is just not about comics. It's about the geek pop culture. It's more of a pop culture convention than
of a pop culture convention nowadays.
Yeah. And it's more than that. And because it's just the energy there. I mean, you have to go. It's so hard to explain.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to experience it. But, I mean, with this story, that was kind of my mission. I was like, look, I want to show... I made the story, yes, for the geeks and for the people that are familiar with this, but I made it more to the people that were like myself that didn't know much about it. It was my way of educating and saying, like, look, boo, you're part of it.
Yeah.
You just don't know it yet. And that's why I wanted to get as many people that were from certain parts of the community that you would never assume are
mm-hmm.
part of it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Tim Duncan, he did the Punisher.
Oh, yeah, we know. Yeah.
Yeah.
We know. Tim Duncan actually plays role-playing games. Vincent and I write role-playing games.
Okay.
So we're always like, hey, Timmy, you want to come play a game? Because I would love to play Dungeons & Dragons with Tim Duncan.
Wait,
we need a
good?
You
that
know,
would rock.
Yeah, that would rock so much.
You know what would be cool, too? Vin Diesel. He plays
D&D player,
Dungeons & Dragons, too. Yeah.
And so is Will Wheaton.
Well,
yeah.
Will Wheaton.
I've met him. So is Al.
So is Al. That's another show.
That's an awesome guy.
We're not even going to talk about Will Wheaton because they'll just freak out.
You guys need to educate me. I need to learn more about these. I want to know more about game style.
Yeah.
The last game I played was Mortal Kombat, and it was Nintendo. It was in the 90s. And I
that was still a great game, though.
It's the best game. And I would I would do the multiplayer thing, but I would tell my sister to leave the room, and I would kind of fight myself so that I would win.
That's nice. Because
the machine always beat me, so.
Yeah, hey, that's how some of us have to play. I still, like, move the controller to this day. I still move, yeah. It doesn't work like that.
I'm jumping. No, just press a button.
Oh, with the...
Yeah.
I need to be updated in video games. That's you know, you, my sister, she's one of the general managers for GameStop here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice.
And I'm like, girl, like, teach. And she's like, oh, I can't teach you.
You need to learn. You definitely need to learn.
No, when I'm playing Call of Duty, I'll duck my head when I take incoming fire, even though it doesn't make a difference.
Yeah, it's funny how we all do things like that, so... But that ties in, too. There's, like, a little seepage of everything, you know? There's... The superheroes come into the video games, and the video games go over into the cosplay, and the cosplay, you know, goes over into the comic books, which is something I might be talking about.
And then you just, like, see it all there at Alamo City Comic Con.
Yeah.
And, I mean, there's just something for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and if you're not into... the art. That's the thing that kind of, when I see people creating stuff, that's the thing that kind of grabs a hold of. And then, of course, you know, the celebrities, and depending on which celebrity you're there for. But it's just awesome. I didn't get any rest that weekend.
You don't rest,
but it doesn't matter. You don't even notice
until that final day, and then you're like, oh, Lord, have mercy. What have I done? Yeah.
I had to get an extra day, book an extra day at the hotel that last year. So I was like, I just need that Monday just to rest, and I don't think I can check out early enough.
We have been there, so we feel you.
Well, luckily this year, we're going to be at the con. We'll be at the con as Geek Out SA. And we're not going to be helping do the back stuff for Alamo City, because we used to be part on the staff of Alamo City.
Okay.
We ran tabletop games and did all kinds of stuff. And so now we're going to take a break.
Taking a break, because we have our own con to go to Game Expo. But... Well, you know what? Before we even get to that, why don't we go ahead and play the footage and have you just
exclusive.
Exclusive. Only Geek, has had this first out on the internet.
Bam.
How much work goes into... putting a convention. I've heard that you don't sleep before, that you're always working.
I'm always working.
How much work? What's the process like behind the scenes?
It's not an 8-to-5. You know, the dark side of Alamo City is that I don't have a personal life. I go on dates. I don't have a girlfriend, because there's that sacrifice that I've done. It's everything.
With only 48 hours to their sophomore show, Apple and his team work hard around the clock in order to make this a smooth and effortless event. From the carpets to the banners, everything is fair game.
This year we have more time to set up, so it's like last year we only had one day. It took a year to plan it, you know?
Yeah, it's really good.
Nah, it's coming nice together.
And it's nice that you guys added the other exhibit hall C to help out with registration.
It's going
to
be huge.
It's going to be a nice circle flow.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
It'll be a nice.
That's what I love about it.
Yeah.
There's a sacrifice that has to be made. And not only for myself, but my staff and their lives. So it's not an 8-to-5 deal, and it's not Monday through Friday. Comic-Con work comes at you when it comes at you. And so, you know, my Monday is the same as a Sunday.
The challenges of today was just seeing where everything's going, and actually, like, the crew did everything that they were supposed to do, and just basically seeing where all the signs are going to be put up, and everything was trying to get everything here on time, and that's it.
you know, I love what you did last year. I love what you're doing this year. And I thought, man, I gotta do it too.
It's nice. It's good.
It's fun.
What's up, bud? Our things are. Yeah, no. I'll give you those exhibitor passes for them. But no, man, I mean, we got to take care of, you know, organizations like that, dude. I want to watch out for anybody that's walking in this booth. I don't want them to get hurt. Just be safe when y'all walking right here because of this metal thing right here. You're going to see it on a grand scale, and you see the design of it from the carpet to the banners to the pipes and grapes to dealing with vendors, dealing with artists. There's so much that goes into it and the planning of it that it takes a year.
Just the whole structure is just a work of art, just like a comic. I mean, it's beautiful. What goes into it's amazing.
I don't know if he just takes 3-4 hours, close his eyes, and go to sleep. During the con, I don't think he sleeps. I think it's almost like a 48 hours straight or 36 hours straight. It's sometimes, you know, I don't know how he does it.
So from comic book artists, writers, publishers, even your favorite actors, on the TV screen, little screen, big screen, anything related to pop culture, you're going to find it at this weekend's Alamo City Comic-Con, and here to talk to us about it, we're talking to Apple De La Fuente!
How are you, sir?
How's it going, guys?
The producer's got a kick out of your name. It is not, it is definitely Alfredo.
Right, yes. Middle name's Apple. So I just like buy
Apple tries to keep it local. He wants everybody to take part in it. He uses media the right way. The way it should be used. Apple has a good head on his shoulders. He knows what he wants San Antonio to be.
September 26th to the 28th from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. at the Henry B. Gonzalez Convention Center. All this information, if you happen to maybe walk in the room halfway through, you can catch it all on alamocitycomiccon.com.
Yay, and keep watching to win all the swag. We've got details on that coming up next.
Superman, Spider-Man, and Wonder Woman, or a few of them.
And then again, all the dynamic downtown, and while everyone will be fighting for her up and check out the Star Trek.
Alamo City Comic-Con is on at the Henry B. Gonzalez Convention Center this weekend.
The lines to enter the Alamo City Comic Convention were exploding like the planet Krypton, with people eager to be a part of another exciting and historical year.
This is my first Comic-Con convention here in San Antonio, and my impression so far is that it's huge.
This is like the most awesome thing ever. I've always been like, I don't know, a closet nerd kind of.
It's amazing. It's amazing.
It's kind of a rite of passage. People go through it together. They experience it together. In anthropology, we call that a state of communitas. But in this case, you're going through a shared sort of creative experience. You come out inspired by that in different ways.
When we first had it last year, we didn't know what to expect and how many people to expect. Now this year, we're expecting a lot. So with the space, there's more people that are able to come in where we don't shut down due to capacity. I've seen around 50,000 people here this weekend, and we're not even done yet.
And we're back, and that was awesome. I can't wait to see it.
I cannot believe you cut all that footage and everything. Yes. It looks fabulous.
Thank you.
It was really professional.
That's a
looking.
Tough thing because for the longest time I've been trying to get somebody to do that kind of stuff for us because I don't like doing it.
It's fun. No, it's fun. It's kind of like I call it kind of thrift shopping. Because you're like, oh, what did I get today? But no, it's fun. A lot of work. It looks fabulous.
Yeah, it does. What kind of challenges came with doing that?
Oh my gosh. Well, the challenges were, there were a lot. I shot about 450 hours worth of footage with interviews and B-roll. One of the challenges was, story-wise, was figuring out a balance of making everything flow and what was too much, what wasn't too much, what do we need a little bit more of, right. what can we go down on. It was, what other part would it be a challenge?
I can't imagine, though, having 450 hours and watching it, and some of it you've got to think, man, that was really fabulous, but it doesn't really work. with yes. where my vision is, right? That had to be difficult for you to sit through and do all of that.
A lot of Advil and Tylenol.
So of how much footage did you shoot to get, because it's going to be like an hour?
It's an hour.
How much footage did you have to take to cut it down to an hour?
Oh my gosh. I mean, I don't even know. I just know 450 hours. And the rest...
And it's only 1 hour, people. So and only 1 hour. So he went all of that to get one beautiful hour. And it is... It looks fabulous.
Like, thank you.
Just from the preview, when you first sent it to me, you never know when people are sending you stuff on Facebook. Vincent and I have gotten some interesting requests and stuff on Facebook, right? Look, check out this thing that I did. And you're like...
50 Shades of Grey, homemade.
You're like, oh, sad. Right? And you don't know how to respond. So when you sent yours, I was like...
Here we go, again.
Okay, God, here we go, right? And I clicked on it, and I was like, shut the front door? Really? This looks good. So, yes, it was fabulous.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I wish I could even do that, because I do an okay job, but I can't do a job like that. No, well, not that well.
And I just want to point out that I reached out to y'all only. I was like, I want to do a good podcast. So I was like, you guys are like the Jay Leno.
Ooh. All right. Woo-hoo. We're moving up. Thank you so much.
Is that what they're saying about us now?
It's not what they're saying about you. I've heard what they say about you, and that ain't it. No. Please.
Well, you know, hey, everybody has their Conan O'Brien, so. Mm-hmm. You know.
There you go.
But yeah, no, I really, really like that. I can't wait. When is it coming out again?
So you guys, the full story comes out on September 6th on YouTube. The full story comes out. But if you can't wait to see it, you guys can go on this Monday, August 31st at 7:30 p.m. at Alamo Draft House Park North. I was gonna say Alamo City. No, Alamo Draft House Park. That's 2 weeks later. Alamo Draft House Park North, and you can see. For the first time, there's limited seating, so get your tickets now because you don't want to miss out.
Where can they get tickets?
Well, they can go to alamodrafthouse.com. Mm-hmm. They can go under, I think it's calendar or events, and it's under Park North, and just click on the 31st Syfytonians, or go to facebook.com/Syfytonians. Syfytonians, Syfy.
Tonians.
Yeah.
So it's spelling. It's sci-fi, like when we watch sci-fi on TV. So it's sci-fi, S-Y-F-Y, and then Tonians, like San Antonians. So T-O-N-I-A-N-S. So
well, we're all Syfytonians.
Yeah.
Better than sci-fi Dagans.
So what made you come up with the name Syfytonians?
That one was hard because originally I was going to call it, I think it was Attack of the Alamo Nerds, because I love Star Wars, and then I was like, no, because I don't know, it didn't have that kind of, I don't know, I think pop, and it was one day I was editing, and I thought, well, you know, because you know, you have Lady Gaga, she calls her people the little monsters,
mm-hmm.
You have Nicki Minaj, who calls her people the Barbs, the Trekkies, Star Trek.
Yep.
So I was like, well, what are the San Antonio nerds? So I was like, well, they're Syfytonians. And it had that kind of feel and that kind of...
It does. It has a really good ring.
Yeah, it has a good ring to it.
With something
I can agree to that.
But
definitely.
That's hard, too. People don't even realize that you have to really think about all of these things, all of these different aspects when you're putting something out there. Like, how does it sound? Is it too long? You know, is it going to confuse people?
And it doesn't come to you right away.
Are we going to get...
We're going to get banned
from
being
on television for saying Pinchy Games.
Don't say that word.
That was the name that you guys had originally?
Yeah. That's still our name.
No, that's the name of our gaming company. Okay. Vincent and I create
that's
games.
That's a cool name. You have to be creative.
One person said something about it, and then they pulled it off. JT Street.
Well, technically, if...
Well, JT Street didn't do it. Fox did.
If you're... If it's Univision, okay, but technically, if you speak only English, you say pinche, so instead of pinche, so, actually, I'm Puerto Rican, in Puerto Rico, pinche is hair clip.
Yes, well, that's what we tried to explain, is it depends on where you are in the region for what that word means. Like, growing up here, it kind of means it kind of means like stupid. It's like that stupid thing or that dumb thing or that thing that I don't.
Well,
want
it's more. It's more like an intensifier. Like.
There's not really an
English. Get off. Because the reason I came up with it, I was like, my mom and my grandmother would tell me, get off your pinche games. And they'll swear up and down, I never said that.
You did.
And, we would say that, but it was more like damn games, or it was just an intensifier to what you were trying to say. You're emphasizing it.
And then we tried to look it up to kind of explain it to people because they didn't understand. And then we found that it meant that in different regions. In one region, it actually is a term of endearment. So it actually isn't used like that.
Yeah, it's like my little pinche. And then also in another Mexican culture, it's also means kitchen help. Well, so there's a pinche tacos in California.
Oh my gosh.
And that's what they use as the thing. Oh, pinch is a kitchen help.
Well, it's just like in do you guys know Spanish?
Uh-huh.
So it's just like in Mexico, bicho is fly. In Puerto Rico, it's the male's reproductive organ. So it was interesting when I first moved here 10 years ago, I heard a woman saying, ay, me pican los bichos. And I was like, oh, my God.
Oh, my God, what are you like, saying?
So that was the...
Well, I had heard somewhere, because I don't really know the Puerto Rican Spanish as much, but like a tortilla here is different than what a tortilla is over there.
Yeah, well, a tortilla in Puerto Rico, from what I know, it's like an omelet.
It's like more like an omelet. Yes. Yeah.
Over there, what do we call a tortilla? I don't know. I think we just call it like a burrito wrapper or something.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. We do eat tacos like when you go to restaurants and stuff, but it's just rice and beans all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And
plátanos.
And plátanos. Oh, you know your stuff. Okay.
Yeah.
And the tostones. And Christmas time. The best time to go there for food. Yes. That was a hard part to give up. So.
Do you go back and visit every once in a while?
I do. I go back usually. My dad still lives there and I have some family that lives there. So I'll go back. But I'm one of those, like, after 3 days there, I'm like, okay, back to San Antonio. Because this is just comfortable. And, you know, I forget sometimes. I'm driving. Oh, I'm Puerto Rican.
You're like, oh yeah, I'm from here. This is interesting.
Well, it's a U.S. territory, but you're still y'all have still been trying to get your statehood.
Vince, I love that you know that. That's awesome because you'd be surprised at the things that people say. When I had a high school teacher, asked me one time, oh, what are you going to do for Thanksgiving? And I said, oh, I'm going to go to Puerto Rico. Oh, are you going to drive? I was like, well, no, because you drown.
Are you going to drive? Like, oh, my God.
She's like, oh, but you're legal. So she still thought that I was talking about driving through the Rio Grande.
Oh, my God.
And I'm like, are you kidding me? But no, now people kind of know more that Puerto Rico is a U.S. territory.
Yeah.
U.S.
Well,
currency.
There has been more of a voice of trying to get more fairness in Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm. And I think that's definitely something that we should be addressing.
It's the same as San Antonio, believe it or not. It's just everybody speaks English, American currency.
Mm-hmm.
So we just speak two languages.
Mm-hmm.
And people speak faster Spanish. Crazier. Actually, the American English is very like British. The Mexican Spanish is like the British. And the Puerto Rican Spanish is like the American English. So.
Interesting.
Interesting, yeah.
See, we learn something every day. I appreciate that. Thank you. So, Syfytonians.
Yes.
I saw that there was something in the current.
Yes, well.
Is this more about you, or is it about... No, show the camera.
Show the
camera.
Okay.
Yeah, because if there's any green in it, then
it's going
to disappear.
So, today, I was featured on the current magazine, and we were featured on the... So, we were featured on the current magazine.
So, it looks like this.
On page 21, and...
Let's see.
I'll be
Vanna.
And Kiko Martinez, one of the brilliant film critiques here in San Antonio, did a little story on it here on page 21. I woke up. I'm not a morning person. And I was like, I have to wake up and get this.
Producer man. So it's right there on the corner on page 21. And it says, "This is awesome." No, I don't know. I didn't
I keep reading and I was like, oh, that's there. And it has the artwork that I did. I was kind of inspired by that film Animal House. And I wanted something kind of...
Yes, yes, yes. And I was like, that looks like something. That looks like something. I was like, what is it? It just looked real familiar. And now you said it, I was like, yeah, Animal House. That's it.
So I drew it, and the great team at Guardian Knight Comics painted it,
nice.
I love it. It's
Who painted it?
Wes.
Yes.
Yeah, we figured.
Of course.
he's like the best colorist there.
He made my day, because I just gave him like the outline, and I knew it was gonna be amazing because I've seen what they've done there, but one day Apple texts me, he's like, oh, look, this is what Wes did. It made my week. I was like, I knew it was going to be awesome, but I didn't know it was going to be this epic. So I love it.
Yeah, they do a good job, and they just released their Gears and Bones recently.
They've been showing off signings and stuff like that. So since you did this artwork, I didn't get to ask you about it earlier. Are you doing anything with the artwork aside from just kind of using it for advertising?
Right now it's just kind of just for advertising and, you know. But I do plan, I am working on a follow-up to Syfytonians.
Oh.
So stay tuned on that. I don't know, I'm planning on doing maybe like t-shirts. I don't know, I'm still thinking about what to do with that.
Okay.
But I
think it's cute. I'd get a postcard. Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Or a poster. That'd be cool. Yeah.
We have some wall space going on over here.
I'll give you guys just for geek artists.
Thank you.
We'll take it.
We'll take it.
We're not ashamed. No. So what other things do you do? So this was kind of new to you, right?
Yes.
So are there any other things that you do in the geek culture? Do you read comic books? Do you cosplay?
No, I do. Me and my assistant, we were talking about this year cosplaying. I don't know how we're going to pull that off because, you know, when you're doing the interviews. But I wanted to do either like Kill Bill because I love Quentin Tarantino.
Okay.
But I wanted to do a little cosplay.
Oh, nice.
Uma
so you can be in the yellow jumpsuit.
And she looks kind of, she's not Asian, but she looks kind of, so I wanted her to blue salute. Or I love Lindsay Lohan, so I wanted to do Mean Girls, and I could be like Lindsay.
Oh, yeah.
But that was just, and it's just for fun. I mean, that was just kind of, but I don't know. I don't know how we'll pull that off. Or Kylo Ren from Star Wars.
Yes.
But again, I don't know what's going to happen. So I'll just...
You know, you would be surprised how even more accepting people have become of kind of what we call a thrift store cosplay or casual cosplay.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I just bought Hogwarts leggings.
Oh, my
and
gosh.
I bought a really long... I bought a men's 2X so that it would be long. Hogwarts shirt, and it had the houses on it. And I got some 3D glasses from the movie and, like, scraped the 3D off so that I could do my Harry Potter. And that's my casual cosplay.
So Luna Lovegood.
Kind of, well, actually, I kind of do
a little bit of not cosplay, but I do kind of. I think with like throughout the Syfytonians, I kind of wore certain pieces, like with that clip that you guys saw. So I was wearing, that was a Burberry nautical yellow and blue knit sweater, and there was a reason for that. Apple de la Fuente is a huge Batman fan.
Mm-hmm.
So in my research, I found out that the original 1960s TV show, the colors that popped out the most were yellow, navy, and light blue. So that was the purpose for that. So it's kind of like a little hidden thing. And there's some stuff throughout the story you guys will see. In the cover art, I'm wearing the Shining Rocket sweater, which was beautifully created by... Teresa Gonzalez, she's a crocheted artist out of, what's the, Pass Bernie? What's the name of that place?
Fredericksburg?
Fredericksburg.
Kerrville.
She's out of Kerrville, and she crocheted this beautiful, exact recreation of that sweater. So there was a metaphor behind that, too.
Oh, wow.
So I like to kind of play more with metaphors, but I want to cosplay. I'm dying to cosplay.
I think that would be fabulous for you to cosplay. But I like that you do the metaphors. So Vincent and I try to do, we don't do the metaphors, but we try to, because we have like 9 billion t-shirts. So that's one of the things that we do is what are we talking about? So by looking at my t-shirt, people can probably figure out what I'm going to be talking about. you know, or what it is that, you know, is going on in the show or in the community, we try to kind of, you know,
showcase
what it is, mm-hmm. you know, so that people can get that feeling of, oh, hey, I can wear that, I can be into that, and I'm not over the top, or, you know, I don't look a certain way, because there are stigmas sometimes, unfortunately. Right? And I'm a big girl, so yeah. sometimes I have a problem
girl,
with the cosplay.
Please.
Thank you. Don't even play. But, and I have a friend who's really big who does the cosplay, and there has been some grief about that. So Vincent and I are always trying to, like, champion people in, you know, cosplay. Vincent wore Ghostbusters. He did Ghostbusters one time. Mm-hmm. He just wore the Ghostbusters t-shirt under, and he had found, like, a jumpsuit that a guy wears, like, at the, like, to fix cars or whatever, and he just kind of wore it over the top and did, like, Ghostbusters there. And it was just, like, really casual, but it was kind of that play on the Ghostbusters.
Well, I've cosplayed kind of around Halloween. I think the craziest one that I did was I did the Miley Cyrus. and it happens to be women. I'm not one of those, like, I'm not like that. Like, but it's costume. You can have fun with it.
Yeah, you can have all kinds of fun.
Making light of it.
And you look like this.
Oh, yes.
Oh,
I
was sticking out your tongue.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
But she has the longest, biggest tongue I've ever seen. I'm like...
She's descendant of Gene Simmons, obviously.
And
must
I was
be.
Holding the foam thing. And, of course, you know, I'm a guy. The thing was small. So it was... I had to wear, like, a lot of, like, something to cover it up. So that's the craziest. But, yes, I would love to cosplay. I think maybe... Well, when The Last Star Wars came out, I dressed up as Darth Vader. So I don't know if that counts.
That does count. That totally counts.
It does.
I'm trying to get my cosplay points up.
Yeah.
So. I think you need to build your cosplay
points.
Up. Well, since we're talking about Syfytonians, let's talk about what's happening in the sci-fi world with the Hugo Awards.
Oh, no. Do not get me started on the
Hugo Awards. We got to talk about it because it just happened.
Well, okay. We do have to talk about it because it's some of the ugliness that's still happening in the community. So I don't know if you're familiar with what the Hugo Awards are.
Yes. Well, Vince was telling me a little bit about it before the show. Unfortunately, what happened?
Yeah, so the Hugo Awards, and for if you're not familiar with it, Worldcon was actually in San Antonio. So it's a big con that moves around, and you kind of try to get votes for what city the con is going
to
go to.
Yeah, so this year it went to Spokane, Washington.
Because they won the year that they were in San Antonio. So they were the next event.
But that's, if you ever want to go to, it's not a big convention. It's a decent sized convention. It's not a big convention, but at like after hours, they have like these big floor parties, to where all the hotel rooms are open.
Oh my gosh!
And you go in there, and they'll give you food or drinks or whatever.
Like a dorm party?
Kind of. They're trying to showcase, like, their area of town. So there was some place in Canada that wanted to win the Worldcon, and okay. So they had, like, poutine, and they had, like, a poutine martini. It was so disgusting. It was horrible. But
it was somewhere in Canada.
Yeah. But it's interesting because they're throwing all these themed things, and so you get to go around and, like, try these different cultures and see these different things. So the Hugo Awards, you would think, being a sci-fi award, and here's this big community, and it's the mm-hmm. World Con, and we're bringing everybody together, that it would be like a little kumbaya, kind of like s'mores fire kind of thing.
And
no,
then the Sad Puppies came.
And the Rabid Puppies. So
and
it's
the Rabid
Sad
Puppies.
Puppies. And the Rabid Puppies, they named themselves. And they're these two groups that were trying to stack the Hugo Awards because they're tired of feminists. They're tired of gay lobbying. They're tired of what they say is supposedly not good sci-fi that has different races in it, different genders in it, different sexualities in it. They want that to go away. How could they? What are they thinking? Like, what is wrong with them? There is only one storyline in the world? Not true.
Yeah.
If you want to be a good author, if you want to put forward a good story, you need to look around you and wake up.
Yeah, and one of our viewers was really taken aback by that, and he didn't want to have anything to do with like fandom anymore.
Yeah, just
because of that,
drop his whole fandom because of these attacks like this, and it does happen a lot. Being a girl, I know that it happens a lot. I have a lot of friends, and they call them fake gamers or fake geeks because they're girls. Yeah. What was bad with the Hugo Awards was people tried to go the other way and fight them And so in a lot of categories this year, there was no award. Nobody got to win.
Well, because the Hugo Awards just decided, you know what? If you're going to stuff the ballots and try to, you know, cheapen it like that, we're just not going to give that award away.
Well, people got to vote, and that's one of the options, is to vote no award. So they just voted for no award. So then there is actually good literature out there that should have been talked about and showcased, mm-hmm. and it didn't get any recognition because of people like this.
But the funny thing is, the whole difference with comic books is not nothing new. I mean, you look at what Marvel did with the X-Men when they first came mm-hmm. out. If you look at X-Men, they're kind of a, I mean, they're kind of a play on human rights. I mean,
oh, definitely.
Interestingly enough, Ian McKellen, you know, he is openly gay,
mm-hmm.
and you know, he said that when he took on the role for Magneto, that was one of the things that convinced him, because he knew the struggles that he had gone through. I think what other.
Well, the comics are still struggling that yes. with that today. They now have the new rendition where Thor is a female. And so that was a big uproar for people. Look at how people responded to the new Ghostbusters movie.
Yeah.
Oh, kill it. Down yeah. with it. Like, why are you putting chicks in the Ghostbusters movie?
I can't wait to see it.
It looks mm-hmm. fabulous.
But you know what? I'm all for female empowerment. Mm-hmm. I love, I think it's time. I think for everyone.
For everybody, but, yeah. Not just for women.
But I love... For what's happening, if you look at, for example, UFC, which is a part of pop culture,
mm-hmm.
for a while they had kind of fizzled out. Nobody was really paying much attention. Now you have Ronda Rousey, mm-hmm. who's come back, and
yes.
she's...
And she had a bunch of haters and naysayers and talking about her physique and calling her name.
She's looks hot.
Yeah.
She's beautiful.
Yeah.
She's
yeah.
gorgeous. People are ridiculous. Yeah.
And I was like, you know, it was successful, so... I think, yeah, that's unfortunate that kind of stuff is happening.
It is unfortunate, but that's one of the reasons why we want to talk about it on the show, is because people need to put a voice to it, and we
yeah,
need to
and
say
just
positive
because,
things.
Just because it's different doesn't mean it's not good.
Yeah.
But
if the
but it should be
bad,
good.
Okay, yeah, we're supposed to be interested in the storyline.
Yeah.
So if I read it and the storyline is bad, or I think it's lame, I'm going to say, hey, go back to the drawing board, that doesn't work as a storyline.
Or if they just, like, make something, oh, let's make it a female. Oh, let's make this a gay character just to make it a gay character or make it a female character. Unless it's good and they're writing a good script for it and to explain why it's happening, why are you doing that?
Yeah, it has to have a purpose.
It has to have a purpose, and they can do that.
Yeah.
But they just, oh, let's just throw it in. Let's just make them...
Well, even Stan Lee, and we talked about this before, he told people recently, because they were changing up a lot of the characters that he's already created and trying to give them a new ethnicity or whatever, and he said, you need to go create your own character. These characters are already realized. They already have their life in this spectrum.
Yeah.
You be creative.
He said,
you need me to, I'll write it for you.
Yeah.
You know, here's this 90-year-old man shaming you. You need some help? Like, I'll write it for you. Don't try to piggyback off of something. Don't, you know, find your voice, get out there, talk about it, and make a new character. There's lots of things we could be making and creating and adding to. So.
And there, I mean, I always say there's so much, I mean, if you really think hard, there's so much material to cover.
Oh, yeah.
You never know. I mean, the possibilities are just...
And the world is ever-changing,
yes.
and in ways that we didn't even foresee, and in ways that we thought we were going to be certain places, and we're not there yet, so we can still imagine, like, beyond that, and, like, nanotechnology, and all kinds of stuff. There's all kinds of stuff that we could go forward with.
Hey, if a book like 50 Shades of Grey can sell, could you imagine all the great stuff that we can... All the actual good
mm-hmm.
literature that, you know, this community can make?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
Yeah, that's what we need to do,
but
is empower some good literature
yeah,
and move that forward.
Y'all should write something.
Please, I don't have time for that.
We write games. That's
write
what
games.
We're into.
Game.
Yes,
yes.
I write games.
I don't know, an interactive game. Like, kind of like a game where, like, you have to go in there and, I don't know, print out. I don't know.
Maybe you should come to Game Expo
you
and then
game
we'll
game
play
I
some
have,
games.
I will
give
come
us some
to
ideas.
Yes, I will come to Game Expo this year.
Okay.
Yes,
I
yes.
like it.
Promise.
We'll get you set up, because the main people that do it are right in this room.
Right here. This is the trifecta right here. Wait, Al? Shh, no, don't tell him. He doesn't know.
he doesn't know he's part of the trifecta.
Oh, I'm not very good at the video games. I can teach you how to play, like, tabletop. Like,
tabletop, okay.
Roll the dice, and you don't have to have a whole lot of...
Okay. So, table... Is that, like, tabletop? I'm going to come out so ignorant. I'm sorry. Is that, like, blackjack and...
It's like a step above that.
It's like a step above...
It's like Monopoly on 5-Hour Energy.
That's why... Take me under your wing.
We will teach you some stuff.
We've got some games to teach you.
Okay. A ton of games to teach you.
And room party.
Yeah.
Yeah. What happens at the room party stays
at the room party.
Okay. So no documentaries on that.
Okay. I promise.
You got to watch this when he's got
off
a camera.
Off the record.
So I was going to ask you earlier, actually, speaking of being on camera, what kind of camera did you use?
I used a Canon 60D. I was surprised because I kind of been learning little by little. I mean, when you start this thing, I started out with like $150 cheapy picture camera.
Yeah,
you start upgrading, and I mean, if you were telling me earlier, and so I've been using that and I loved it. I mean, the picture quality was great, and it was the first time that I'd ever edited something on Final Cut Pro X. Usually I edit it on other software programs.
I knew the word too, and I couldn't think of it, so you weren't alone.
it worked out very well. And the great thing is you can get it anywhere. You can kind of, because it's big, but it's not big enough. And a lot of people use those for these conventions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What we actually started using is a iPad Mini.
Yeah,
okay.
That's really good.
And then we have we put it up on a tripod. It has the enclosure.
Well, I saw some of your interviews that you did a couple weeks ago.
At Gen Con?
Mm-hmm. And I was like, I need to talk to Vince, because, like, what kind of camera are you using? Because the thing looked good. And the audio was great. So
It's this thing right here.
I use the cheapy lavaliers, and I have to be buying them over and over. And I've heard that stuff is really good.
Yeah.
That one was really great. That was a really good investment. Yeah.
Can you put lavaliers in it?
Yeah. As if you can plug it in a quarter inch or the XLR,
okay.
You can plug it in right here. It's got two spots for it.
Like if they're walking around, like if cordless kind of.
Yeah, but it has to have one of those connections that you pop in there.
Okay.
But yeah, you can do that.
To catch the signal, yeah.
See. But you're able to adjust the levels on each side, so that's a good thing about this. And they also have a zoom. This is the cheaper brand because it's not as heavy.
Okay.
But I like that it's not as heavy.
But everybody's. I've seen many people using that. It's funny. I went to Best Buy the other day, and they had a good selection on that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh, a lot of people are embracing the good microphones.
Well, yeah. There's been a lot of good reviews coming out on that because we were reading up on it. Because you have to trick the iPad. Because it doesn't have an audio feed, so you have to make the headphone jack think that it's getting headphones, but it's getting audio in. So it's kind of like, I don't know, he has like a cord connected to a cord connected to a cord that does something.
That was actually designed for someone to record their guitar on an iPad.
No way.
Yeah.
But that's also will allow us eventually to start taking calls on air.
Oh my gosh, I'm excited. Yeah.
So once we figure out all that technology and get it all integrated, then we'll be able to take calls.
How do you stream
live calls
before?
Well,
we don't know yet.
We don't know
we
yet.
We haven't gotten that far.
Okay. we're going to have Al back there.
Yeah,
hello?
You have to think about those things. You never know who's calling.
You can do it.
Yeah, hello. So I guess I'm going to have hello?
Pepperoni pizza.
Hello?
So what is your next project?
Well, I'm working on a couple things right now. So I'm a huge Star Wars fan.
Yes.
I'm working on a follow-up to Syfytonians. But before that next follow-up comes out, I will be doing... I'm a foodie guy.
Oh, okay.
So I wanted to do... Yeah, I'm one of those people... I like to watch movies, and I kind of want themed foods. Isn't that weird?
Yes. No, that's fabulous.
Yeah.
No, we love that. That's totally
a
thing.
So I was like, okay, well, I know I'm excited for Star Wars. What if I do... leading up to The Force Awakens, an episode that deals with different recipes, themed recipes for each film. So it's called Syfytonians, and it's Syfytonians, I'm still figuring out the name, but it's, right now it's the Star Wars nerd guide for food.
Awesome.
Too long. I'll fix the name. But so far I have Watto's Taco Truck. That's going to be
nice.
Episode one.
Nice.
And I have an idea of like a drawing or something I want to do. Bantha Milk Frappuccino. Bantha Frappuccino.
Really?
So, because I love Starbucks and I've seen the Bantha Milk and I'm like, okay, let's make it fun. I love a vanilla bean Frappuccino. So, mm-hmm. Bantha Vanilla Bean Frappuccino. Yoda Soda.
Oh, cute.
Macaroons. BB-8 macaroons. French macaroons.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the other one? I want to do something with kind of like the Mustafar lava, something
mm-hmm.
like that.
Well,
so.
Did you see, Vince talked about it a while ago, that Disney
yeah,
did
Disneyland.
A pop-up restaurant?
No.
Yes,
yeah.
They did
yeah.
a Star Wars
everything
pop-up
Star Wars
restaurant.
Thing.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
They did the dark and the light sliders,
oh.
and there were little burgers on the different, like a rye bun and a white bun.
Did they have, like, colors? Like,
yes.
For the,
mm-hmm.
okay,
yes.
Okay.
Or they had, like, a Darth Maul bisque?
It was like a red pepper, yeah, and they decorated the top of it, and it looked like Darth Maul.
Well, so, I love food. I think that's why, again, gets me in trouble in other areas. I'm wearing a good shirt today that covers
that's
these
it.
Things. So,
don't go upstairs because
yeah,
we might push you down
no.
them. Well, that'll be fabulous. Yeah, we
yes.
love that kind of stuff.
Yes.
So, I do Pinterest boards for Geek Out SA.
Okay.
And that's one of the things I do on the Pinterest boards is I pin cocktails and different food things that you can do
well,
for the different geeky episodes.
Would you mind coming on to one of those stories?
I might.
You have
yeah,
to. What's your
that.
Favorite Star Wars movie?
Let's see. What is my favorite Star Wars one? It has got to be Return of the Jedi, I think. It's got to
okay.
be my favorite one.
Okay.
So I'll have to think
on.
Of some themed stuff.
Yes.
I can think of something.
Yes.
Just watch me.
So you can do the cocktails.
Okay.
I hadn't thought of that. You
yeah.
can do the
cocktails.
Cocktails
are
yeah.
fabulous. Yeah.
That's very cool.
What do you want? Which one's your favorite?
Empire Strikes Back.
Oh my God. Okay. That yes. That's the best one in the series.
Yes.
I wish I could live in city Cloud City.
Really?
I always wanted to live there. That was
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't like Lando. I always want to slap him in the face. Yeah. Every time I see Lando, I'm like, just like, shut up, Lando. I hate you.
I thought actually for the new Force Awakens, I have a feeling that the new character, I forget the name of him.
I don't know.
Stormtrooper.
But I know.
You guys know which one, the one that's
the
like...
The Stormtrooper and he's there. Yeah.
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 So I thought that... I have a feeling that there's a connection to Lando. Like he's Lando's offspring. Like that could be...
All I know is that I know in the poster, he has a lightsaber.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But then who did Luke marry then?
All I know is my mind was blown
Mara
by...
Mara Jade.
Yeah. My mind was blown by the whole E.T. Star Wars connection. Have you seen the E.T. Star Wars
yeah.
connection?
Oh,
oh no, yeah.
yes.
In
episode one,
there were hidden cameos.
Way
yes.
down in the corner.
Yes, but here's the whole thing about that explains it. Okay, you see, of course you see him in the Capitol, but you in E.T.,
mm-hmm.
What's his name?
When they're trick-or-treating.
Yeah, but when he's the kid is playing with Star Wars figures.
Oh, he's got Greedo and Hammerhead.
Yeah.
And E.T. points to it, and he's like home or something like that when he's playing with the figures, right?
And when they're out trick-or-treating, he does see Yoda.
And he goes straight for Yoda.
And he's trying to go after Yoda.
Home.
Yeah.
He goes to Yoda.
I never seen Poltergeist. I saw it 2 months ago when the other one came out. But I was like, everybody told me you need to watch the original. And
yes.
that one has a lot of Star Wars reference because his room is Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
His
yes.
light thing is Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Well, ILM did all the special effects.
Okay.
That was one of their first movies. Amazing. It still gets me to this day.
I haven't
love
seen the second
it. It was
one.
The first scary
yeah.
movie that I saw when I was a little kid, Poltergeist. Oh, my God. To this day, love
no,
that
it
movie.
It still scares the pants off me.
Yeah. Love it.
Well, did you guys see the new... Was it any good, the new one?
The new one was pretty
no,
good.
No, it was pretty good.
No, the new one was
what's
pretty
it?
Good.
Yeah.
yeah, you won't be as disappointed as you thought. We thought we were going to be disappointed. No, it was actually really pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I dug it.
Yeah, I dug it. Especially when they go...
But the
they
little girl is...
Inside...
Just know that the little girl is not called Carol Ann.
And there was a reason for that.
Yeah.
They were afraid of the poltergeist curse.
Yes.
From what I heard.
Yeah.
I've heard that. I don't know how true that
yeah.
is. But there's some really good scenes where the little boy goes in to save her from the other side, and we get to see the other side.
That's the thing that I didn't
Ooh.
Like. Yes.
So that's really cool. It's really creepy.
Yes,
creepy.
Russell just said E.T. is a Jedi. But here's the thing. Why E.T. is a Jedi? Okay, so all of that is there, okay? It's apparent that he's in the Star Wars universe, but in E.T. way back then.
Right.
So here's you see him in the Senate in was it episode one.
Mm-hmm. He's protesting.
So he's in, or his people are in there.
Yeah.
And then at the end of E.T., he levitates bicycles with him in it and the kids on it. So that makes him a Jedi. Because he can do that.
Force.
Oh my God.
He's using the Force to do that.
I know. Right? Yes. When I read that, yes. I was like, shut up.
I know that they like to pay homage to Star Wars, like in Indiana Jones. George Lucas, mm-hmm. They had, like, in the stone, they had the R2-D2. In Close-Up Encounters of the First Kind, you see an R2-D2 stuck to the ship.
E.T.
E.T. I now have to go home and watch it. what was the other film? Even J.J. Abrams. There's a quick shot, I think it's in the last Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
YouTube it. And they show, when something blows up, they show, like, an R2-D2 flying through.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice. So, R2's everywhere.
Yes. It's kind of like an homage.
Yeah. I think they did something like that for Firefly, too. They would, like, do little references like that.
We all got to connect. On Firefly. It's got to be connected. But, yeah. Just like in Syfytonians. That's what it's all about. You got to connect.
C-3PO and R2 are in the Egyptian temple.
Yes, that's how it did. When he's getting the rock or the gold thing.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
I always love a good Easter.
Yes. And Russell also just said, was it better than Fantastic Four? Anything was better than Fantastic Four.
I went into that movie with a certain different point of view. I was like, oh, you know, maybe it'll be good. And, you know, 10 minutes into it, oh, yeah. It's, and then I was just like, this is not even Fantastic Four. It was something else.
We renamed it the Fantastic Flop.
I would rather see that Jennifer Lopez flop from 2004, Jilly, 10 times.
Oh, gosh.
That's saying something. I would rather see Jilly than Fantastic Four 10 times.
Wow.
In a row. I think Fantastic Four would be great for whenever they're doing waterboarding against terrorists. Just play Fantastic Four. Is that bad?
Yeah, that's...
No, the Geneva Convention prohibits that.
Prohibits playing Fantastic Four. It's not humane.
I mean, that's worse it's than playing the Barney song over and
yes.
over.
Yes.
Well, and I heard... I don't know if they're still doing that, but that Fox was still going with a follow-up.
No, they canceled it.
No, it's dead.
Yeah,
it's dead.
Okay.
But they have.
They were.
Say that.
Yeah, they were.
It before the movie actually opened. Mm-hmm. But once it flopped, they cut their losses.
I like the Chris Evans, and I thought that one was good. The one.
It didn't hold true to the comic books.
Okay.
As a movie, I thought it was good.
Yes. I liked.
Well, at least the first one.
Well, I hated it going into this one, and then after seeing this one, I was like, damn, I love that movie.
I like the Silver Surfer.
Yeah.
But again, I never read the comic. I had only seen the cartoon show mm-hmm. back in the 90s. Well, they would pass reruns in the 90s in Cartoon Network.
Oh,
so that's
gosh,
how I
so
connected to it.
We yeah, got to see that Alamo Drafthouse. Where Syfytonians is it going to be?
Oh, that's right.
On Monday.
Monday.
So you
Monday.
Definitely got to check that out. Alejandro, thanks for coming hanging out with us. Yes. We had another story, but we went way long.
I'm sorry.
But it was great.
It was fabulous. We can talk about The Walking Dead later and all that other stuff. We can't talk about it anyway because we might ruin it for Al. So.
Oh, I saw it.
Oh, he saw it this time.
But maybe we'll do another cut and do something special for them. And we'll talk about two more things that we had to talk about. Or maybe three or something like that. But Alejandro, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
We're definitely going to check it out Monday, the 31st.
August 31st. 7:30 p.m. Alamo Drafthouse Park North. Get your tickets now because it's going by quickly.
Heck yeah.
And I can't wait to see y'all there.
Yeah,
I know
we'll be there.
I know it's a school night for you. But
it is a school night. Yes. Every night's a school night, okay. So that's all right.
But you get Wiggins off.
No.
That's
not true. Ask any teacher. That's not true.
But thanks for tuning in. I'm Vince.
I'm Alejandro Cabrera.
I'm Colleen.
Geek out, SA.
Bam.